Welcome to the Dickinson College Expert Show. I'm Craig Lane. Thanks for being here. Today we're joined by biology professor Scott Boback. Welcome.
Thank you.
Great to have you here. We're going to talk about a project that has really been getting a lot of attention, and it's called Project Rattlecam, and I love that name. An exciting way to watch rattlesnakes, and you can check it out by going to rattlecam.org or just going on YouTube and searching for Project Rattlecam. So Project Rattlecam has been a bit of a labor of love for you. How did this get started?
Yeah, I guess it's kind of been in the progress over several years now. We have a site in Colorado where we're studying rattlesnakes, and you know, it's difficult to get to Colorado for me. So there's a logistical thing here, but yet we're continuing to want to study them, want to study the behaviors. So we kind of started this project putting up still cameras and taking still photos of the snakes at regular intervals. So they have it set to time lapse, and we'd start accumulating all of this data, and we could see some really interesting behaviors. Well, it was always our vision, actually my collaborator Emily Taylor's vision, really to sort of bring that to the internet so that we could both simultaneously bring the view of rattlesnakes to the public while at the same time kind of obtaining data ourselves on the snake's behavior.
Right, and when we say view rattlesnakes, we're talking hundreds or maybe even thousands of rattlesnakes, right? This is what has been termed as a mega den.
Correct.
Tell us about the scope of this then, what people are going to see when they log on to rattlecam.org.
Yeah, so what we'll see is you know, oftentimes the camera is zoomed in on only a few snakes, but what we do know about this site is that there are many, 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 many more animals. And during certain times, they can see several, maybe 20 snakes all together at once. Of course, they don't all come into one tiny, tiny little spot.
Right.
They do spread out a little bit, but we have been studying this general area for several years, and we are confident that there are many hundreds of snakes in this area.
And they get together to give birth. This is the month we are recording this in August, and this is the month when these rattlesnakes will be giving birth, so there'll be hundreds of babies joining them here. Why is it important to study that really crucial aspect of their life cycles?
Yeah, it's really interesting, Craig. Like, you know, we don't often think of snakes as being good mothers, caring for their young. But in fact, we believe that rattlesnakes do this, and there is data out there already prior to us doing any of our work that suggests that the mothers actually defend and take care of those babies. The interesting thing about it is, well, for me, not necessarily for everybody, but for other folks that are in the science and snake world, is the fact that those snakes are giving birth all together in a group. So what you might envision is 20 mothers, mm-hmm. expectant mothers, one of them gives birth to a bunch of babies. What are those other mothers doing for that, or the expectant mothers doing for the one that just gave birth? Are they going to defend that area and essentially protect those babies? Those babies aren't even theirs. And so we have a scenario essentially set up here where other mothers could in fact babysit for another mother. And how that works out is really very interesting to us. We want to know, are some of those mothers related to one another? Would this be like sisters that are giving birth? And if that's the case, as we all know, sisters share genetic material.
Right.
So therefore, if one sister gives birth, the other sister helping to care for those offspring, it makes a benefit, and it sort of makes sense that she could care for those offspring. We don't know that yet. We probably are not going to find that out through this study only, but we're doing additional studies to try to find out the nuances of that stuff.
This really is nuanced then. So you're looking at sort of a snake familial or societal kind of situation going on here. I guess in many ways, maybe breaking new ground of their interactions with one another and the habitat that's around them. So if folks are watching this, can they help you do these observations? How does that work?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, I'm not really familiar with some of this stuff on YouTube, but I've become familiar with it, and I can see the feed coming out, and then there is the chat, and there's, so there's the chat function, and people are logging on, they're viewing, and then of course they can voice their something they maybe see, something that they have observed. And what's happening is they're starting to identify individuals. So you can actually go back in time through the video and take snapshots. And you can find a individual snake that has a really good view in that one scenario, and then fast forward, maybe going waiting another 5 days, getting another view and looking at that snake's pattern and matching it up and realizing that, hey, this is the same individual. So if that's right, the case, then we can actually start to discern some of these relationships.
Right. So this snake may have been on the surface in view of the camera, may have gone back into this rocky crevice or outcropping where this is in Colorado, and then come back out.
Exactly.
That's fascinating. So a real way to have some citizen science engagement here. That's got to be exciting for you that this like will encompass the 11,000 plus subscribers that are now on this YouTube channel.
Yeah, I can't even believe what this has become. There are people that when they log on, you know, this goes all day long and then it goes at night. But even in the morning time, you know, we think it's, you know, morning time, Eastern time is not morning in other parts of the world, obviously. And people are logging on to the channel. And they're saying, hello from Poland, hello from, you know, wherever, just all over the world. And that's really, you know, very heartfelt to me to think that we're reaching people all over the world. Granted, not everybody wants to, you know, pull up their channel and look at snakes. But like you said, it is a way to view this from a safe distance and look at the nuanced behavior that these snakes do, not this, you know, rattling and popping their head up and striking or fake striking. Instead, they actually can see them doing their natural behavior, which is a lot more passive, slow moving, and potentially interacting with one another.
Yeah, really, really fascinating. I think that too, this might change people's perception of snakes, right? I mean, because snakes often play the villain role in a lot of our mythos and literature, and if you're out hiking and see a rattlesnake, chances are you're not going to want to go make friends with it, or
absolutely,
you shouldn't.
Absolutely, and you know, it is really terrible to think about that there are some people that kill animals and they really dislike them for you know, big reasons. That's not surprising for a snake. The snakes are dangerous. This snake is a venomous snake, so it has some inherent danger that people should be aware of and stay away from. However, if we can get people to see these animals for their true selves and realize that a rattlesnake is indeed a good mother, it's much harder to get somebody to do harm to an animal that is actually a good mother taking care of her babies and watching out potentially for others.
Right, a lot of emotions at play too when we learn more about these creatures, rattlesnakes, or really any animal that we study more in depth and learn more about. Now this is a partnership. You have first selected the site in Colorado. There's another site in California. You've been working with Cal Poly researchers on this as well. What does that partnership bring to this whole project?
Yeah, that's a great question. So, you know, I really enjoy collaboration where scientists can get together and share their individual expertises together on a project. And that's, in fact, what we have. My colleague, Dr. Emily Taylor at Cal Poly, she's also a snake biologist, of course, but she has other expertise. So she's a physiologist. She's an ecophysiologist, we would call her, sort of ecology and physiology. That's not my area. And so she comes from a different place. I come from, you know, a slightly different background. But together, we really can do some really interesting things together. And it's always helpful to have other people that are coming up with ideas, and you can share ideas with each other. And it's really a very stimulating environment. So
it sounds like you're having a lot of fun with this, especially the interaction with people on the internet. Have there been any moments that you're like, oh man, we're really making a connection, we're making it happen now?
Yeah, it is very surprising to me. I didn't think we would see these kinds of things, but people are reflecting on the on what they're seeing, and they are literally saying that before this video, I was terrified of snakes, and now I'm seeing them in a different light. And this is just in a tiny little chat, you know, where they've got limited numbers of characters, but they're literally reflecting that. Again, not all the people are doing that. Some of them just kind of log on and just kind of look at it for a while and then get off. But for those that are continuing to get on, it's very encouraging to think about the possibilities.
Absolutely. And tons of press for this. It's been all over the news here in America. Washington Post, you were on NPR, so congratulations on that. It's just wonderful to hear about this project. What are the next steps for Project Rattlecam? Where do we go from here?
Yeah, that's a good question. I think my colleague, Emily Taylor, would like to extend this to other locations. So we know that there are other locations where there are very large dens, more animals, different species of snakes, and the possibilities really are endless for the ability to kind of get out there. Clearly, it costs money, so we have to get over that funding hurdle. But with the right amount of support, these cameras could go up in multiple locations and really reveal that hidden scene that we often don't see, even when there's a photographer there, right? Because the photographer is influencing that environment. They're sitting there behind the camera.
Right.
When you have these remote cameras, the animals have no idea that they're there. They're silent, and they're often off in the distance and can zoom in from afar. And it's really exciting to be able to see those behaviors.
All right. Professor Boback, thank you so much for your time. Really a pleasure chatting with you.
Thanks, Craig.
All right. It's Project Rattlecam. Rattlecam.org is the website, or you can just go on YouTube and search for Project Rattlecam. I'm Craig Lane, and this is the Dickinson College Expert Show. Thanks so much for joining us.